They took away time and gave us a clock. The story of the cuckoo clock. You know the story of the cuckoo clock? This man had this pot, and the police were coming to raid. He had the police coming up, and he didn't know where to hide this pot. So he hid it in the cuckoo clock. And the police came and searched the place, couldn't find the pot, right? And split. The police left. Now the man said he was desperate. Now he wanted to smoke. So he went to the cuckoo clock, right? And he said, well, he tried to open the doors, but the doors are stuck. You know, the doors are stuck. You know, there's a pot inside. He said, well, I'm going to get a hammer. You're going to smash this thing, right? You're going to smash this thing. He said, well, now, okay, maybe you should wait until the hour comes. You know, the hour comes and the cuckoo is supposed to come. Cuckoo, cuckoo, cuckoo. So wait 1 hour, nothing happens. I think the doors remain shut. He's going to break this thing open. I mean, he want to smoke. Like, right? Okay, let me give it 1 more hour. You know, 1 more hour. Nothing happens, no cuckoo. He says, this is it. He's just about to smash the clock when the doors open very slowly, like, and the cuckoo comes out with shades on, right? With dark glasses on. and the cuckoo says, hey, baby, you know what time it is, man? Cuckoo's completely out.
Timing. Do you get timing?
Hey, I want my
See, District Six was an incredible place, man. It was home. It was home. Not just for families, it was the home for a whole culture. Separated from loved ones, but maintaining that spirit of togetherness. So the song itself, or the sound of the song, serves like a link between the people who leave or are forced into exile and those within the country. And that hopefully, inshallah, after the revolution, this song will serve as a rallying point. Mannenberg, I think we all know, is a township in Cape Town. Perhaps the counterpart of more well-known township called Soweto. Soweto is in Johannesburg. Mannenberg is the counterpart in Cape Town. And a sprawling township. And of course, when the Group Areas Act came into power, people were forcibly removed, like from District 6, which was the center. In fact, in the city was a section of Cape Town, the city of Cape Town, where our people lived. When the Group Areas Act came into effect, people were thrown out. And the first group of people that went, for example, to Bontehevel, and later on to Manenberg. So Basil, for example, an old friend of ours and musician, tenor player, moved from District 6. The family was forced to move to Manenberg. We went in the recording studio, and we had rehearsed a lot of other pieces. And during an intermission, I saw this. See, we were recording on a grand piano. There was a little upright piano standing. I went over to him and touched it, and he said, "Ah, this is another sound." They had a tact. You know, you put tacks on the hammer of the piano. That's why upright piano is perhaps sometimes better than a grand piano, because the sound hits right back to you, back at you. And play the sound. I said, and then this piece came. Pretty. And he said, "Well, the saxophone players, why don't you take the line?" "Ba ba vi vi ba da ba." "Okay, but now we have to get a bridge to come out of it." So we said, "Okay." Ba ba da da da. Ba da 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 da. Da da di da do da da. And we said, "Well, what is the song about?" And of course, we were recording in Cape Town, and our first thought was Manenberg, because it was the sound of the mood of the people at that time, right? Now, several things became involved, or like our lives crystallized in this the song, you see, because a few months later, when the album was released, Soweto Uprising. So now many years later, see, we sit and reflect, but okay, what were the ingredients? Because we are sound scientists, You know, I said, take our music and analyze it. Contrary to the idea, you know, that in Africa, we just take up a saxophone and play, you know. we put in a lot of time and study and analysis, and analyzing and say, okay, Manenberg, firstly, it's in the key of F. Now, the key of F is, it activates the physical body. The key of F, exactly where it's positioned. Different keys activate different parts of the body, different aspects of the body, perhaps this at another time. But F, the key of F, activates the physical body. Now, the sound scientists in Africa, if you want to listen to what it's called so-called avant-garde music, you heard all that stuff is in Africa. Because there's a stereotype, the image of what Africa is supposed to be. When you see African art, you see people with grass skirts dancing around. But it's much deeper than that. Now, our sound scientists, right? If you want to hear sounds from anywhere that is being played, you know, so-called avant-garde or modern sounds, it's long been experimented and played in Africa. It's, for example, like the bagpipes, right? You know the story of the bagpipes, right? You know the Scottish, bagpipes, right? They have a reed, they blow through, and then they have a bag, they fill it with air. Because the principle is that you must have one tone that is constant, that drones, right? Like, now that drone, you see that constant drone. So what they do is they fill a bag, blow full of air, and that bag holds this drone. And when the bag runs out of air, you have to blow it full again. But in Africa, the only thing that people do, you have two reeds, right? One reed has got the drone tone, and the other reed has got holes so you can play the melody on it, right? And you use circular breathing. Which is, piece for this, for the Cape Town Symphony Orchestra. They couldn't play it. They didn't, you're not technically equipped to play the music that we write. You know what I mean? There was one phrase that was 10 pages long without one breath. You can say, where do we breathe? I say, you don't know circular breathing. You know, technically equipped. We're very advanced in Africa. We're advanced. Now you come, there's a Mannenberg. You say, wait a minute now. The Mannenberg is in F, right? And it's pure, at that time when it was called Marabe. Marabi, the term Marabi comes out of Marabastat in Pretoria. You know, it was a township in the 40s, 50s, right? Now, Marabastat, this is where the music emerged, because at that time people couldn't afford pianos, so they had those little organs. What do they call them? Harmoniums? They used to play those harmoniums. Now, what they used to do, they set up a tone, a scale, right? And they would press, you press the key down, right? Then you put a matchstick in there, which holds the note down. Then you take maybe another note, and you put a matchstick in there and it holds it down, right? So you choose your tone row, and then when you pump, you have the basic sound, and then you can do your other stuff with it. You can use the matchsticks. Very hip. But, and now, marabi is like... Prime moving force of music, and the music, of course, this basic pattern has gone through many, many changes, but the basic pattern stays there. Maybe the rhythm changes, you know, or the instrumentation changes, but the basic pattern, when we analyze the pattern, we find what it is, you see, it's like, oh, okay, that's your scale, right? Right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, now, if you say, that's the first chord, that's the second chord, that's the third chord, one, that's the second chord, three. No, actually, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it's 1, 4, and 5. Now, when you analyze the music and the actual music on the instrument, and the sounds, when you relate it to your life and to the universe, you discover that one is earth. I mean, one is heaven, which is Father, right? Five is earth, which is dominant, five elements, five. Four is the child, right? Now, if you say, okay, if you play a chord on 5-1, right? In this key, in key of F, you have B flat there, right? Number one is F. That's the first chord, that's the second chord, that's the third chord, right? Now this note here, if you take the key of, if you take the fifth, you'll find that note is in there. So what it actually means is, number five is the mother, that note is the mother pregnant with a child, right? And when you play that note, you have to come back to one. So you have father, child, mother, father, child, mother. And that's why it doesn't matter where, we play the music all over the world. Just that basic marabi. You play it in China, we play it in East Berlin, we play it in Harlem, we play it in Tokyo, we play it in Finland, it moves.
Charges the feeling.
Perfect timing.
Timing is arriving at the right point at the right time with the minimum amount of effort. In Mannenberg, right? When Basil, you know, Basil could see the tenor player, saxophone player, related us the story. And told us the story. And so we imagine our Saturday morning in township, right? I mean, you've never seen so many children anywhere in your life than a Saturday morning in the township. Children. People going shopping, cats, dogs, chickens, right? So here are these two guys ambling down the road, right? Having a little taste. And these brothers have perfect timing. The The moment of perfect timing crystallizes, and everybody focuses in on this moment, right? Losing a beat, he just scoops the girl up and puts her down on this side and takes the joint from the other guy and back to the front. Oh, there you go. Perfect timing, man. The masters, master musicians, man. This song is dedicated to Twanguru because he embodies that spirit of resistance. You hear that we use a so-called Oriental scale with a Western release bridge. Now, the harmonies and the rhythmic structure represent really these two cultures. Was affectionately known as Twanguru. His name was Abdul Qadi Abdus Salam. He was a prince of Tidores. He was exiled to the Cape because he fought the invading Dutch. And at the Cape, he became very affectionately known as Twanguru. Twang means Mr. Guru, teacher. Now, Twanguru's teachings has become like the main force in the Muslim community. Thank you. Kwanguru. It actually started Afrikaans, which is so-called the language of the Afrikaners. Abdul Qadir Abdul Salam was exiled from Tidores in Indonesia to South Africa. And he started preaching in the community. Was one of the foremost and one of the first imams in the Cape. And at that time, of course, the slaves, it was forbidden. Islam was forbidden to be practiced, so it was taught very secretly. And the slaves, of course, could not speak and write Arabic. So what Twanguru did was write the transliteration using the Dutch alphabet. And even today, the imams, when they write Quran or they write prayers, they write it in Arabic and in this transliteration. And that was the beginning of Afrikaans. See, Cape Town is like a melting pot of all these different cultures. You have the Khoi San people, you have Malaysian, the Cape Muslims. You have Khoisan, Indian, Chinese. There's a cross-fertilization of all different musics as well. Now, you have like in New Year, you have the minstrels with the New Year carnival. Around Christmas time, you have Christmas choirs. And what happens is that they play strings, violins, cello, saxophones. And there you have troops, about 200-300 people to a troop, and about 20 to 50 different troops all competing at the stadium. And what they do is like we use the basic Christian hymns, but they put a Cape Town beat under it, right? So here is this is a old little town of Bethlehem. So, little town of Bethlehem, a son of Deborah. So they will play like. We have to get this revolution done and finished. I haven't been in a Christmas choir parade for many years.
Give it a C.
Okay. One, two. One, two.
This song was sung specifically at carnival time. It's part of the show we call Cape Town, South Africa.
Now this song says, "Wuhani pachinari kramat."
Okay, there's a problem with addiction, right?
Oh, yes.
Let's.
Wuhan, Wuhan di.
Oh.
Wuhan di. Pachi. Na di. Now you are saying Wuhadi Pachina di Kramatu. It's Kramatu.
Again?
Wuhadi Pachina di Kramatu, Nadi Kramatu. Wuhadi Pachina di Kramatu, Nadi Kramatu.
Oh, now you're Cape Townians. Can you have a part here? What is the tenor part? What is your first note? C. Ba, and you are? G. Okay, can you give that to the trombone and tenor? And mute. Let me hear rhythm.
Only voices first. Only voices one. District 6 was such a rich, cosmopolitan melting pot that within District 6 you could learn, experience just almost everything. Very, very, very close knit, very close knit community. There's a subculture, you see, of so deep. That only the people within the community can see what is going on, let alone the outsider. So Firetown, Western, all of them, they were closed. You cannot really see. Harlem is the same. Harlem is the same. You can be walking through Harlem and there'll be so many things going down that you cannot see as an outsider. We have Fafi, for example. You see, which is like this numbers racket, the counterpart here. But the numbers racket in South Africa was run by Chinese, because the Chinese have that mystique, you know. South Africa, it's mystique. And they had like 36 numbers. That guy, number one is white man, number two is monkey. I can't remember number seven? Number seven is thief, scallum. Number nine is eggs, ears, diamond lady, moon, right? And then Nungkwai and Katpan. It was number 36 and 37. It's Chinese, Nungkwai, Katpan. The runners are almost like, they're salesmen, you see. But they are like con men, right? But not con men, not really for the money, but to con you out of your dream. Right? So he would turn up in the morning and say, and he was like, he had free access into all the communities, all the ethnic communities, the Fafi Rana. So he would come in the community and say, yeah. And then the family, you know, the mother and the aunties and the uncles and the friends, the neighbors maybe washing, Monday morning washing clothes. You can say, what did you dream? What did you dream last night? You say, yeah, I dreamt about this sea. They say, okay, then play seawater. Did you dream about the ship? He said, yeah, and then play Big House. That's how they work it out. And it was therapy, right, to work out with your dreams. Right? You pay for it, but you have a chance of winning. I remember the seven steps. The seven steps was Buddha Muchi's headquarters up Hanover Street. These steps, they were not actually seven steps. I think they were like five or six of them, but they call it seven steps, like seven steps to heaven. Now you go up these seven steps, and then there's a lane going down to the next street. You go up Air Street. Yeah, Air Street was at the back. Now, on the seven steps, there were always people sitting there, always guys sitting there. I wonder, what are these people? You can go any time of the night and there's somebody sitting there. And what it was like, you would come there, you're going to play some Fafi or whatever. You give him the order.
Hey, how's the right jumper?
Lucky.
Nice one, nice one. Listen, I want 536, man.
Why 36? Double the odds of 37, man.
Come on, that's a muffin number.
37. Down there.
It's too dangerous to give the money to him. We signal you. Signal, they just signal, okay, walk. Walk up this lane. Halfway, there's a manhole, there's a manhole. It was interpreted, it's a very some strange stuff, but what is really happening, this is the South African township underground banking system, and economic system underground, eh? And in a case like this, this is with that guy in the drain is really underground. There's so many good things that were nurtured in District 6. Like on a New Year's morning, you would first hear the daybreak, the muadin, you know. Allahu Akbar! Allahu Akbar! And of course people go to the mosque or Fajr prayer. And then you see this, the carnival erupting, you see this. All these different colors of satin. You see troops coming. Every troop, they had a troop of about 400, 500 people. You know, and there were scores of troops. It was a rallying point for the community. And to see all of them, and to see all of that destroyed, and people forcibly removed to those townships. See, which to us are really concentration camps. That's why, see, our generation, that when we did District 6, it was in the city, it was was flexible. It was beginning already with the Group Areas Act. Now, these young people, this generation now, they know nothing but apartheid. They were born and raised in those concentration camps, those townships. I remember when I was a kid, we used to, the Cape Town Museum, we used to go, like, every Sunday, people used to take, and there was a family, a Hoi family, embalmed next to the animals. There was a Hoi family. They never regarded as human. The Hoi people, the embalmed, they had glass eyes, right? Now, we used to go there, and people, they used to come, and our families used to take them, okay, you know, in the summer, it was like an outing to go to the city, you know, to go into Cape Town from Kensington or wherever we live, get some ice cream, you go to the botanical gardens, and the botanical gardens and the Houses of Parliament and the public library and this museum is right there, right? They have us embalmed right next to the Houses of Parliament. So I didn't really think of us as being human. And I remember I used to have cold chills. They had to half drag me into that section of the museum. They are living in darkness. Complete darkness and ignorance. And you see, we were talking about this other day. See, when we relate what happens to us, we relate it through humor. We relate it through humor. We laugh at it. We laugh at it, though, you know. The reason why we laugh at it is because we do not want to be contaminated. We do not want to be contaminated with the evil, with that evil. So it's a purge to get rid of it in laughter. They are not our teachers. They are not our teachers. They will never make us think the way that they do. I remember there's a song that we used to sing when we were kids. They say, "Khoiri panaku gani pan, da ko halima an. Khoiri panaku gani pan,
Kako halima an, hora doli hora, save your mother's nora. Hora doli hora, save your mother's nora. Where a pan hook any pan, kako halima an.
So, when we came to the States, this was about 60, 60, 66, yes. We came in 66, 65, 66. Somebody gave us an album of Hoi music, Hoi San music, recorded on the Library of Congress folk music series, right? And this was recorded on location in the Kalahari. And there, one of the tracks, they play Ramkiki and Rattles, right? Or Shake It. And it was... Exactly the same song. So there are these layers and layers of colonialism, of colonial darkness and ignorance that has taken us away from the reality and the truth of the music and of our history. And it's absolutely music that is beginning to be unveiled.
Sana dulu babu sofika ekuseni tula baba tula sana dulu babu sofika ekuseni kukwinkanyezi eolelu baba Enkanyisela indlela yekhaya sobe sikhona qabonge beshoyo betibuyela ubuyele ekhaya tula 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 baba tula 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 sana, tula tula baba, unga kali tula bo, kreula kreula tine bezem kinkomo, siya kwesha zikabe lempulu.
So the oral tradition, you know, of South Africa is just translated to the instruments, right? So, for example, if you play marabi, if you say Now, when the alto, the first alto, you know, when he plays the lead, then automatically the other five or other four horns will play the harmony. It's not necessary to write it down. And the experience comes from the oral from that tradition of the tradition of singing and, of course, the church. My early childhood, my grandmother and my mother were both pianists in the church. I grew up with the spirituals. And the reason why it is perhaps my favorite hymn is... It's perhaps the epitome of a four-part harmony, and the way the voices move. Thank you. with favorite hymns. I remember he had an arrangement of Abide With Me. And a beautiful piano solo of Blessed Assurance. So we cannot escape the influence of the church.
I had to physically fight to go for piano lessons.
They said, well, why do you want to play piano? Only girls play piano. You want to say, this is a man playing piano. Yeah, and we had to get rid of all of the flowers and the flower pots and the photographs and stuff on top of the piano. You know? That's war. That's war because it's institutionalized. Okay, the piano is for this. It was hard. It was hard. Because, like with everything else, you had to toe the line. Even artistically, you had to all toe the line. But we were hearing, even socially, we were seeing a completely different thing. And musically, we were hearing completely different. And it was hard for people to deal with it. Because, after the dance bands, when I first started playing the dance bands, they wanted me to play a certain way. And when I started the creative process, I said, no way, there was no way that you can deal with it. Yeah? I had to leave home. I had to leave home to play this music. I mean, when I met Satima, I was living on the streets. I was sleeping on the streets of Cape Town. Because the people couldn't deal with this music. And there was no way that I was going to step back from it, because I knew that it was right.
Thank you. you been here today?
Yes, yes. Yes, I'm helping do it. Just a pain, just a good day is what we get. Only a good day, Mr. Thompson. Have a good day.
Now, to let that music, or whatever it is, to let it flow through you, is like the samurai. It's like state of zen. You yourself have to be completely composed. This is what composition means, huh? Is that you must be composed so that that message can flow through. When it comes, see, when it flows through you, it even serves as a means of purification. And this is the high. It's a state of high, state of spiritual high. Now, when musicians have to deal with this industrial society with iron and steel, it's very hard for them. The physical high, if you want to get high, you jump. And then you must come down. The spiritual high can only be obtained through spiritual means. Now, in order to maintain that constant high, the only way out to maintain your sanity in your health is that you must be completely composed and let yourself become the vessel of the Almighty. Been told or made to believe that the samba comes from Brazil. Samba does not come from Brazil. Samba comes from Africa. On the 26th of March, 1658, a Dutch ship by the name, what was the name of the ship? Amersfoort. The Amersfoort landed at the Cape. Now this time, Jan van Riebeek was the commander of the Cape because he had finally, although he was still trying to convince the Dutch East India Company that it would be good to set up a refreshment station at the Cape, and he needed some slaves. He couldn't get us to work. Mm. This is why there's this ongoing stereotype image of us, or the Khoi, the San, the so-called Hottentot and Bushman people, that we are lazy and shiftless, you know. But when Van Riebeek arrived, they said to people, okay, now let's build a castle. And I said, what? Build a castle? What are we going to go work for what? You were lying on the beach in Cape Town, you know, beautiful summer's day, fresh fruit. Others have a little taste, we're going to relax in the sun. Here comes this man from Europe come and tell us we must go work in a quarry, break stones, build castle. They said, no way, you go build a castle, man. So you're going to get no slaves. Like, this ship, the Amersfoort, landed at the Cape with 300 slaves, which were captured from a Portuguese vessel. Because they were hijacking each other on the high seas, right? For this black gold, which was slaves. So this Portuguese vessel was bound from Angola to Brazil with slaves. And it was captured by the Dutch. And these people were brought, 300 slaves were brought to the Cape. Now, it is quite clear then that there had been slave trading going on between Angola and Brazil. Now, and you know Nana Vasconcelos, the percussion player from Brazil. When Nana first came here in the 60s, Nana had what they call birambau, which is the hunting bow with a gourd and you played with a reed. But this is African instrument. In Swaziland, it is the national instrument. It's called Makoyani. They are the same beat of the samba. I grew up with that in Cape Town. It's natural. And when you go up all the coast of Africa, you find the same beat. We have several themes. We'll play you a one of the themes, right? The other one is... and we say someday soon, sweet Samba. When all the spirit of all this exploitation and dark ages, living in the dark because there's no knowledge, because they've been effectively trying to keep to suppress this knowledge. In time for the new nation has come. How does the song come? Sometimes it comes in bits and splits. Sometimes it comes in a whole composition. Like one night you play something. Most of it came in the next evening. We completed it, and when it came, like musicians said, "What was that?" And I remember Jimmy Woody. This was at the sound check, right? Jimmy Woody, the bass player. Jimmy said, "That sounded like Monk." You know, and subconsciously, I remember I had been thinking about Monk, and we call the song "For Monk." In fact, we have a whole suite dedicated to him. It sounded like Monk. We all agreed. So I agreed with Monk. And that evening, Satima called us from New York. We were in Geneva to tell us that Monk had just gone into hospital, right? He'd just gone into a coma. Just gone into a coma. So when I was young, people used to tell me that Monk. Music, Monk was crazy. In South Africa, when I first said, who is this Monk you're talking about? Even if you want to listen to, I heard Monk for the first time, and I said, oh yes. Now, Miyamoto Musashi said, under the sword lifted high, there is hell to make you tremble. But go ahead anyway, and you will find bliss. See, I mean, there's somebody standing with the sword, you know, they move the sword high. Facing you with the sword, right? Now, there's hell to make you tremble under this lifted sword, but you go ahead anyway, and you will find bliss. You'll find that peace and repose. Now, this is the music. But people tell me jazz music. It's musical. It's samurai. Because, and that's why you find very, very few people, want to get involved in this music. Because it means putting your life online. You see, it's what it, you are given a set of circumstances. Right? Which is your song. Okay, now you learn the head or the melody. Now you have to improvise. Now when you, that first note that you play, you are putting your life online. In traditional society, immediately when you showed any signs of musical inclination, you were immediately drafted into medicine. Because medicine and music together. That's why you have healing songs. Like Maria Makeba's mother is Sangoma. In fact, Miriam recorded some of these healing songs. Right? Now, in this society now, musicians are misplaced. Now we are seem to be entertainers. But what we do is that for public consumption, we are musicians. We can play the music, but we inject this healing therapy within the actual performances.
Water from an ancient well. See the rain clouds gather from the steaming hope of loving hearts beat drum. Too long the tongue has tried, nay, dried. The patient desert waits. See the bodies fall like raindrops, nurture, love, dust, deep root intention. Now unveil, the Karoo desert blooms again. Joyous comes the golden flowers, the purple shrubs, and sunset green. What shall quench our burning thirst? Let me drink. Let me drink. Let me drink from thee, O beautiful Africa. Forever ye's perpetual wisdom, succulent sustenance, sustains my song. Water, water, water from an ancient well. Oh, beautiful Africa, that's where I'll always dwell. Water, water, water from an ancient well. Let me play you a little of more. Thank you.
When we say water from an ancient well, when we talk about the drought in Africa, the famine, the turmoil, we are not, when we ask for rainfall, we are not asking for water from the sky. We're asking water from that ancient well, and it's not the physical water, it is the water of wisdom from the ancient ones, so that we can face the future. The people have started to dig ancient wells. Very soon, Africa will be green and blooming again.
Thank you.